play a game, you know, when I will have to tell you that you are left with 10 minutes or 15 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, excellent. Well, now that we are recording, everything seems to be set up. Welcome, everyone. Thanks for coming out to play today. What we're going to do today is a session that comes from liberating structures. As many of you know, I love visual facilitation. I love using pictures to share information. I love using pictures for people to have conversations, because I think while it's really powerful when you have a facilitator in the room who is capturing ideas graphically, it's even more powerful when you put a marker in everybody's hands and you allow everybody to participate in the conversation. So I'm just actually going to pause here for a moment, because for this session, you will need a marker and maybe a couple of pieces of paper. And if you don't have one at hand, I want to give you a moment to just go and find. Bonus points if you can find two markers, a black one and something that's a bright or a light color, but one marker will do. But we'll just give people a moment to find them, because I see a couple of people have gotten up and gone to look for something. I'm just using scrap paper to draw on, nothing fancy. Although I might use my super high-tech whiteboard book as well. So while we are waiting for people to grab materials, I want to ask you, and I'm going to ask you to drop your comments in the chat, is how do you think, based on what you know already, based on what your experiences have been, how do you think that bringing graphics, bringing drawings, bringing visuals into a communication helps with communication? What does it do for you? If you want to drop your comments in the chat, I'd be curious to see what you think. Got, yeah, grabs people's attention, because it mixes things up from just the talk. Here's my Excel spreadsheet in my PowerPoint presentation. It helps, you know, there's great stuff coming out here. It allows all voices into the room. It gives everybody a chance to participate. It helps build shared understanding, and it can build shared understanding of bigger ideas, right? Because we can communicate very complex ideas very quickly with, you know, a back of the napkin drawing. We can see how all the pieces fit together. And it often takes a long time to explain those things. So when you put a marker in everybody's hand, it gives everybody control. You can overcome some of the cultural challenges and misunderstandings that people have different perceptions. You know, we can all use the same word and it can have very different meanings. And sometimes when we add to our understanding by drawing pictures, we can help surface the different ideas that people have, the different meanings that people are bringing to whatever situation. Reduces language barriers, reduces some people aren't as comfortable with talking, with sharing their ideas. I know it's probably hard to believe, but I'm the kind of person who doesn't talk a lot in meetings. And having a way, giving people a way to express themselves besides just talk, really helps level the playing field and allows everybody to bring their ideas. And there's lots of things, you know, to the last point somebody put about how the brain retains the visuals for longer. There are lots of things that adding visuals to sharing information, absolutely. And especially if you're doing it in a fun way or in a way that really engages people's emotions, right? It allows our brains to process the information differently. Sometimes it helps bring out new ideas because we're exercising different parts of our senses, different parts of our intellect, but it also does improve retention as well when we bring graphics in. And so the exercise we're going to do today is about how can we have a pretty deep conversation about change using some really, really simple drawings. And this is the other point that I want to make too. One of the things that people are often reluctant about when about using drawings in the workplace is they think, oh, I'm not an artist. I can't draw. It is not, you know, this is not how I should be expressing myself in a professional situation. And there's two things I want to say about that. One, when we are using drawing for communication, it's really not about the artistry. you want your drawing to be clear enough that people can sort of get what you're going at. But it's not about beauty. It's not about detail. It's about communication. So as long as what you're drawing is good enough that everybody can look at it and go, that's a dog, that's a square, that's a dollar sign, or, you know, it's fine. And you can also use labeling to help with that too. But it's also, you know, you can convey very simple ideas, or sorry, very complex ideas using very simple drawings. And that's what this exercise makes use of. So what we're going to start off is, everybody's got something to draw with, I hope, because what we're going to start off with is drawing some very simple shapes. And I'm going to, this is where I am going to experiment with using my trusty whiteboard to demonstrate. And then I'll show you a picture of what it is I'm actually trying to draw. We're going to have a conversation about change, and we're going to use drawings to represent five very simple ideas. So I'm going to ask you to draw along with me as I explain. The first shape that we're going to use, very simple, we're going to use a circle. And in this exercise, this circle is going to mean wholeness. It's going to mean becoming whole, becoming complete, making, you know, bringing something together. So everybody grab a marker, just draw a circle. Doesn't matter if it's perfectly round, we really don't care about that. You might want to draw a couple. You can draw big circles. You can draw little circles, you know, all sizes. If they don't quite join up, it doesn't really matter. But if you just draw a little bit slowly and a little bit carefully, it's actually really easy to get the ends to join up. So don't sweat about it. The next shape we're going to use is, we need something to talk about goals. We're talking about change. It's where are we going? And we're going to use a triangle to represent that. Now I'm going to teach you one of these pro drawing tricks that helps make your drawings look really crisper, which is, when you're drawing a triangle, at the corners, lift your pen off the piece of paper, because that means that you end up with a nice sharp corner instead of doing something like this, where things are round and a little bit uneven. And if you just do that little thing of picking your pen up and putting it back down, you're going to find that anything that has a pointy corner becomes a lot sharper. So we're going to draw a couple of triangles, and we're going to use a triangle to represent the idea of a goal. Just a quick question. How many people were able to find a second color of marker to work with? Got a marker, crayon. Okay, enough of you, because this is where I'm going to show you. Here's another, I'm going to call it a secret professional trick to make your drawings really, really pop. And it's so, so easy. So I've got my circle and I've got my triangle here. And here I've got just a light green marker. I'm going to show you how to give them a little bit of a shadow. So starting with the triangle, which is easiest, I'm going to start a little bit from in the corner here. I'm pretending that the light is coming from this way. So I just put a little light line there and a little line there, and voila, I've got a green drop shadow on my shape. It's not coming up super great with the light that I have, but you can do it at your end and you'll see what it looks like. And it's fantastic, right? You can also do that on the outside of a circle. You could just put your pen there and get it somewhere close to the edge and give it a little drop shadow. If you want to give your circle a little bit of dimension to make it look like it's popping, you can draw the colored line on the inside. And this is just something really, really simple. It doesn't have to be perfect, but if you just work, if you add a second color to your drawings like this, people will go, wow, how did you do that? That looks amazing. And it's so simple to do. So we've got two ideas here so far. We've got wholeness and we've got goals. I want to give you another shape to work with, and I just want to make sure, beautiful. I just want to make sure I don't pick up my permanent marker to draw on my white book. So the next shape we're going to use is, we're going to draw a rectangle. And remember what I said about picking up your pen at the corners? And we're going to use the rectangle to convey the idea of support. When we're talking about change, what kind of support do I need? What kind of support needs to be in place? place. Pretty important concept. So again, pick up your marker at the corners, make those shapes, and here you can play again with using a little bit of color to make those shapes pop off the page or to give them a little bit of additional emphasis. The two other shapes that we're going to need to tell our story is we're talking about change, right? So we probably need something to represent the idea of change. So I'm going to draw a spiral. You can start from the inside, you can start from the outside, but we're going to use the spiral to represent change. I just realized I have no idea if the letters are coming out the right way or if I have my screen mirrored. Hopefully they're coming out the right way. And if you want to, again, here you can use that color to make it highlight. Just a little bit around the edge draws a little bit of attention. And of course, the other shape that we need to tell our story, and this is kind of obvious because we're telling a story about change, but we're telling a story about people. So we need to be able to draw people. I'm going to show you how to draw the simplest person possible. And again, people are going to, as soon as you start putting people in your pictures, people go like, oh my God, this is amazing. Where did you learn to draw like that? And to draw a really convincing person, it's really simple. We're going to draw an oval shape, like a capital letter O, because we want it to be oval because we're drawing an adult person. And then leave a little bit of a gap, and we're going to draw an upside down U. Voila, you have just drawn a person. The oval shape is important because adults generally have oval heads rather than round heads. If you want to draw a child, draw a rounder shape. And leaving that little tiny gap between the O and the top of the body gives the impression of it, because people have necks, right? And if we connect them, it looks like we're drawing people like this. If we leave that little space, your eye fills it in and goes, oh yes, that's a person. They have a neck. Their head is above their body. And here, once again, if you want to make it super fancy, what you can do is use that marker and put a little bit of a color in the head. And on the same side, just draw inside there and put a little bit of color on the body. And wow, you've got a fancy two-color person. And people, you draw that, and I did this all with whiteboard markers, by the way. You know, you do this when you're drawing a sketch on a whiteboard in a meeting room, or you use two colors for the pictures that you're drawing at home and then sharing with your teammates on a camera, and they're all gonna go, my gosh, you have so much talent. Where did you learn how to do that? I wish I could draw like you. You can feel free to share what I've just taught you, or you can just go, haha, took me years of practice. Whatever works best for you. So we have these five ideas right now, right? We have wholeness, we have goals, we have support, we have change, and we have people and relationships. And what I would like to invite you to do right now is I want you to think about a situation in your life where you are going through some kind of change. And given that it's 2020, I'm pretty sure this is happening to all of us on a pretty daily basis at the moment. Every morning I wake up and go, what on earth is going on now? But I want you to think about a situation that you're trying to deal with where you're journeying through some kind of change. And I'm going to give you 5 minutes, and I want you to use these five ideas of wholeness, of having a goal, of what kind of support is involved, of what change is going on, and the people, to draw a little bit of a story about this change. I would encourage you, don't put any words at all. Just use the shapes to draw the story, okay? I'm going to throw up a slide that has these five shapes on them to remind you, and I'm going to turn on a little bit of music, and I'm going to give you 5 minutes to draw this story for yourself. Before I do that, does anybody have any questions so far? Oh, I was gonna say, I see a little hand, but it's actually not, it's in the background. Okay, is everybody clear on what I'm asking you to do? 5 minutes, draw a story about change. Awesome. I am going to share my screen and we will get going. Oh, wait a minute. I actually need to share the screen, not change the screen settings. Share computer sound, share my PowerPoint, play from start, and come on. Oh, screen sharing has failed to start. That's really weird. Okay, anyhow, your 5 minutes starts now. I'm gonna figure this out while you're drawing. Thank you. Okay. So that was 5 minutes. And what I would invite you to do is just hold up your drawing. Flip on your camera if you don't have it on already, and if you're comfortable doing so, and hold up your drawing so that everybody can see it. Awesome. So I'm wondering, I'm hoping that as you started to draw out this situation, you started to think about, hey, what is going on? What is going on in this change story I have? What are the relationships between the different people in the story? What are the things that I'm trying to achieve? What are the things that I have there to support me, right? Sometimes drawing these things out, externalizing them, can help bring insights. I'm actually going to give you a little bit more time to draw, because this is the first draft of your drawing. And now that you've had a chance to think about it, I want to give you another 4 minutes, and you can either build on the drawing that you've already got or crumple it up and start all over again, because it doesn't take a lot of time. Now that you've thought about it a little bit more, maybe you have ideas about how you want to change the size of elements in your drawing. Maybe you've thought about ideas that are more important than other ideas. You want to use a little bit of color to emphasize things. Maybe you've had new insights as you've drawn and you've realized, oh, those two things are closer together than I thought. Those things are farther away, and you want to change your drawing to alter, you know, to show those relationships a little bit more. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you another 4 minutes to finish drawing your story of change. As I said, it's up to you whether you start again or whether you build with what you have, but I'm going to give you an additional 4 minutes, and then we'll do the last part of the exercise. So I'm going to put this up again and share my screen and find something to time us for 4 minutes. Let's see. Perfect. This will be a good 4 minutes.
2, 3, I wake up in the morning at 6 o'clock. They say the maybe coming down. Yeah, yeah.
song goes, that's the sound of sunshine.
Okay, so if you can just finish up your masterpieces right now, before we move on to the last part of this exercise. And I just want to point out, in case you didn't notice, we just spent 10 minutes working together online without talking at all. And I just want to draw your attention to that, because one of the things that I notice is people are really afraid of, oh, if we're all online together, somebody should be talking. It's okay not to talk sometimes. It's okay to use other forms of communication. Don't be afraid of dead air online if it's being used to a useful purpose. But hopefully everybody has their drawing now. I'm just going to ask you, do you want to hold up your drawing so that we can all just take a look before we move on to the, love it. This is awesome. Before we move on to the coolest part of the exercise. And this is where, if you don't have your camera on, I think what you're going to need to do is figure out how to take a picture of your drawing and maybe upload it to the chat when you get to your breakout room. Because what I'm going to do now, and this is my favorite part of the exercise, and it's interesting and it's a little devious, is I'm going to send you to breakout rooms with three people in each breakout room. In the breakout room, what I'm going to ask you to do is I'm going to ask one person to show their picture. And as I said, you can show it on the camera, you can take a picture and upload it to chat, whatever works, but you need to be able to see somebody's picture. And the other two people in the breakout are going to share what they see in the story. So if Ursula holds up her picture, Raki and Jillian are going to tell her what they see in the story. And all Ursula is going to say in response is, thank you. You don't need to tell people whether they're right or whether they're wrong. You're just going to receive their interpretations of what you've drawn. And once you've spent a couple of minutes, once Ursula shared her picture and Raki and Jillian have commented on it, then it will be Raki's turn to show her story and Ursula and Jillian will comment on it until everybody's had a chance to share their story. And everybody has a chance to see what is in the other people's story, or to say what they see in the other people's story. The part of this that I really want to underline, though, is when you share your picture, you don't explain what's going on in that. You just receive what other people see in the drawing and thank them for their interpretation. Okay? Since I'm going to put you into breakout groups of three, I'm going to give you hopefully 6 minutes in the breakout room to have that conversation. Any questions before I do that? Okay, so I can see that Ursula's got some breakout room issues. I'll try and sort those out, but let me set up the breakout rooms right now.
Thank you.
And then I will try to make sure 6 to 7. No, I want 3 participants per room. I will sort that out so both instances of you end up in the same room, Ursula. Okay. There we go. Okay. Create, assign automatically. And then I'm going to move Ursula. Okay. Sorry, I just bear with me while I move to room 2 and move to room 4, and I'm going to open the breakout rooms now. I will see you in 6 minutes.
Don't put me in a breakout room.
Oh, no. Hey, how you doing?
Hey, how you, Ellen?
I am well.
It's nice to see you.
Yeah, it's been a while. I think we've sort of crossed paths at various events recently, but have not been in the same place. Let me just start a timer and bring people back at 11:45. There we go. Oh. How are things at your end? Everybody
busy, crazy, staying safe, staying well, thank goodness, here in New Zealand.
That's good. What's the lockdown situation like where you are? New Zealand seems to be doing pretty well, but I know there was
Auckland had a 3-week thing, but that was over 2 weeks ago, 2-3 weeks ago. But the country's open.
Oh wow. That's
the borders are tight, but the country is open.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
That's good. We're just
yeah, we don't even wear masks.
That is fantastic. We unfortunately are not in that situation here. We're heading back into a period of tighter restrictions again because things are going in the wrong direction.
Yeah, we had a blip. We had a community outbreak and they put us back into lockdown for a couple of weeks and it squashed it. So that's what we would hope for. We had an election yesterday and Jacinda Ardern won the election. You know, I'm not surprised.
The take I heard on it from this end is, hey, wow, when you get an administration in who does a good job and takes care of the things that the nation takes care of, they get reelected. Who can think?
Yeah, who would have thought?
Who would have thought? Indeed. Hi, Elizabeth. Everybody is in breakout rooms at the moment because not debriefing, but interpreting the results of the drawing that they just did. So,
no problem. Sorry, I drop off every now and then with our network issues.
No worries. Do you have a drawing that you did? I don't know if you were in the session all along and just came back or. Well, shall I put you? Oh. What I love about the Zoom backgrounds is the drawings disappear. Would you like me to drop you into a breakout room? Because there is time left.
It's fine. I'll just hang around quietly.
Okay. I was going to say, Shane and I can tell you what we see in your drawing.
Nothing. let me take the virtual background off. Sorry.
So how are things at the Agile Alliance?
It has been, I will just say, 2020 with a vengeance. Awesome. So I can definitely see there's some change going on in there. So what I see in this picture, I don't know if you're familiar with this particular liberating structure, Shane. But sure. The idea is that the spiral represents change. Mm-hmm. The rectangular shapes are about support and the triangles are goals. And then people are people in relationships.
Yeah.
So what I see going on in that drawing is I can see that you've got a few people who are going through change and are maybe not seeing the goal that the other people see because of the change. And there's a big block of support, but it's not clear whether the support is actually helping any of the people or possibly getting in the way of them coming together. So that is what I see going on in that story.
Yeah, you're quite right. So yeah, in South Africa, we're still at level one. Lots of the companies are still remote. And working with remote teams is one of our biggest challenges. A lot of them don't like the video. The support structures are falling apart. Unfortunately, in our team, we've had a lot of their family members being affected or passing away. So, there's just not, there's so much change happening. They just want to get back to the office and it's not going to happen. So yeah, it's just for me as a Scrum Master, I'm finding that we're trying to support, but the goal is just being hidden from everything else. So yep, you're quite right.
Wow. It's amazing how much information you can pack into one piece of paper and a couple of squiggles, isn't it? Constantly amazes me.
Actually, it would be interesting if I get my daughter to draw something like this to see what her story tells. She's 16 and the change they have been through is unbelievable. You know, just schooling and trying to cope in their own age groups, never mind the adult groups.
Yeah, no, it's just it is a trying time for everybody, I think. Yes. Even I am daily grateful in terms of not having been directly affected by illness, not having been directly affected by job loss. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I think for everybody this year, it's just everybody gets up every morning goes, what now? Really? What's happening now?
Yeah.
Why?
I must admit, you were saying you're from New Zealand. I think New Zealand handled it so well and early enough to have the, you know, the response you guys have. In South Africa, level one, you walk around shops and you're even scared to go to the shops because people are just not adhering to the rules and that. Yeah. So it does make it very difficult.
Just a second. How do I make the timer stop? There we go. Okay.
My wife's family are all in South Africa. We lived there I lived there for 27 years. So yeah, we see what's going on there. Craziness.
Yeah. Somebody said to me the other day, it's the educated people that are becoming ill and the uneducated that don't, because they not phased, it doesn't stress them out, they're not worried about it, they just go about their own ways, where the people that are educated are more concerned and they become stressed and worried and that. So it's actually quite interesting the way they defined it.
Interesting. I've just closed the breakout rooms, by the way, so people will be popping back in over the next 30 seconds.
No problem.
I think my session, I think, is on this line. So.
Excellent.
Okay, we are back.
There we go. Welcome back. I think everybody is back now.
All right.
So I'm curious, what was that experience like? What did you learn in the process of this crazy exercise of using a couple of squiggles to tell what I'm sure were rich and complicated stories?
It was a very interesting experience. I mean, let me start with that. You know, there was a little bit of a glitch because the images were so small when you were in the camera, because unless you speak, then the image becomes like bigger on the screen. So sometimes you had to really work hard to figure out what was the image, you know. So, but other than that, I think it was a great experience because some of the stuff, we got it right, and some of it we didn't get it right in terms of interpreting the story, if you will. But I think part of it was because the images were so small, you couldn't really make out some of the stuff, you know, in the small camera.
So
what we said to Palomi was, you know, keep humming so that the image becomes bigger and then we can try to, so that was our approach. But great work I had Palomi and I had what, Jillian? Yeah. Excellent drawings and, you know, I'll let them speak now, so.
Yeah, so Ellen, from my side, it was a great experience in terms that my drawings are awful. Okay. But today I was able to get through messages by simple stuff. So simple stuff works for me. I means whenever I see people who are like artistically good when they're drawing something. And I am like the basic round and square, and then you, those, that simplicity helped me at least put forward my idea. And that was a great experience. Thank you so much.
I think, follow me, I think that happens because that's just my viewpoint. That when you see somebody drawing much better than you, instead of trying to figure out what is drawn, I think you just start judging yourself. Oh, I'm so bad. That person is so good.
It happens. I have hard time drawing straight lines, man, and people draw. I don't know.
But in this period of full disclosure, that didn't happen in the session we were in. Okay, so nobody criticized the drawings.
Ellen, just to remind you once that we are left with 10 minutes. So the last 10 minutes we have, then we'll have to go back to the main room.
Okay. Well, let's wrap up the debrief in 5 minutes then, so everybody has a chance to go for a bio break before they go back to the main room or the next session. But just so one question I want to ask. First of all, thank you for the tip about when we're doing this virtually. Remind people about how to use speaker view versus gallery view, because being able to switch between those two will probably make the difference between whether you see the picture this big or see the picture this big. So I've added that to my notes. The question that I would like to ask, though, there's two questions that I want to ask, because bringing out the point about using the really simple symbols in order to be able to unlock telling stories visually is really critical. I'm curious if anybody had any insights while they were drawing their own story that sort of gave them any aha moments about that part of the process. I saw Palomi put her hand up.
Yeah, because I used your basic simple stuff, and that triggered the thought process in using some small ideations of my own, like a bulb for an idea, a wave for a brainwave or influencing. So it set my thought process clicking. So that was my aha moment on that.
Nice. It sounds like it helped you sort of clarify what some of the ideas that you needed to represent in this story were. That's fantastic. What else? Did anybody else notice anything during the process of creating their story?
I think for me, I started off fairly basic with the shapes, and you know, I was telling a problem. And when I was drawing it, and then on my second pass through, I was like, okay, wait, that chain, that little triangle could be a sail, right? And then this could be a sailboat. Okay, cool. So maybe the change spiral can be the wind blowing it forward. So I find myself looking at it from a solution, like, you know, okay, this is what it could be. Okay, you know, so I started drawing the end of the picture first rather than the beginning. So I really like that on the second pass through.
That is a fabulous insight about how this exercise works, and about the power of being able to use, you know, as I said, use very simple drawings to help elicit some really deep and rich insights. Anything else about the process of creating the drawings that somebody wants to share with the group?
Yes. So one question, Ellen, here, like as you described, so we got to know like what is the different images, right? Like the circle is wholeness, the triangle is the goal and all. So if we are trying to show this to anyone else who is not getting that what individual pictures are, so how they will be able to depict it? Like, so means either we need to first tell them that what are these images, and then they will be able to make the story or interpret what we want to show or we want to tell. But otherwise, how, I don't know, because we were referring the description of the different images when we were trying to make our story. So that's where my question is, like, is it any way to make it easy for others as well without?
Well, yeah. So the purpose of this particular exercise is to allow individuals to think about their story and to get insights from a group of people about their story based on a shared understanding of the meaning. So if you want to do this have this conversation with a group of people, you need to set the stage about this is how we're using these symbols. The triangle is a goal, the spiral is change.
Yeah.
They're not meant to be lasting objective descriptions of a situation. They're meant to be a tool to spark understanding. So I would think about using them this way, that they are the drawings aren't necessarily, they're not meant for somebody to go back 2 weeks later and go, oh, I know what you were talking about here. It is for a conversation at a particular time where we are trying to develop insights about a story. The question that I want to ask in that developing insights, when I asked that you comment only on other people's stories and don't necessarily share your own, what was that like? What did you notice happening in that process of having people tell you what they saw? Pulomi.
Sorry, I keep on answering your questions, but what I felt was, it was empowering to a great extent to hear and then realize that you could have done better just to make people understand that what you wanted to portray. So there are gaps. And as people speak to you, you get to understand, okay, this person is interpreting this as some XYZ way. Maybe I can do it a little bit better or in a different way. Those thoughts also start coming. So it is a continuous process of invoking your thoughts on how to put forward your insights to other people's. So
that is an interesting insight. And I'm not sure that's come up in the context of this exercise before. It's like, hey, if people aren't seeing what I'm saying, maybe I need to think about how am I showing up? How am I saying it? What else did you notice during this part of that exercise?
This was continuously going. And also what I noticed is that when I'm trying to interpret others on from my perspective, I'm not putting myself on their shoes, which I should be. So that was also another thing that I felt I could have done better, because at the end of the day, we meet a lot of other people from different walks of life, and to understand their viewpoint, we should at least put ourselves in their shoes to interpret what they are saying. So yeah, that was my second insight.
Love it. Love it. Anybody else have any other insights or ahas that they want to share?
Can you guys hear me, first of all?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Before we all go on, I just quickly wanted to bring our attention to time. It is 9:27 and we have to jump on to next session sharp, which will be in the same hall. So don't worry.
Okay.
But the next session will start in another 4 or 5 minutes. So,
Yes.
Okay, so I have
And Alan, you will have to also pass on maybe host right. Sorry, Yanni, yes. Please go on.
I have 30 seconds. I just need 30 seconds. Basically, excellent. All I was going to say was, Alan, that even though the symbols were very simple, okay, but it actually was a challenge to put them together to come up with the story initially. So even though the concept was very simple, and it sounded very simple, but it actually is a challenge when you start putting your mind to it, because you're not used to doing it in that fashion. So I think it needs a little bit of practice to actually be better at it.
That challenge is such an important part of it though, right? Is because we really want to jostle people out of their usual scripts, their usual habits of, this is how I think about what's going
the
on.
The usual ways of thinking, exactly.
Exactly.
When you start with the symbols, you still fall into the trap of your usual way of thinking, and then you struggle with the symbols.
Indeed you do.
Yeah.
So I am that excellent insights. So on that note, and thank you, Deepti, for reminding me about time. I just want to say thank you to all of you for coming out to participate in this today. I've dropped a link in the chat to the instructions for this exercise. As I said, it's one of the liberating structures. If you want to try this with a group of people when you have challenges to talk about, all of the instructions for how to run it are there. And just once again, thank you for coming and spending part of your time with me today. I hope you're going to take what you've learned and figure out how to, figure out how you can take this tool into the circumstances that you work with in order to help people have richer conversations about change. And on that note, I'm going to hand over the host keys to Shane because he's the next person in this room. And I will see you all later. Thank you.
Thanks, Ellen. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Ellen, just to remind you, you can stop the recording here.
So I can. There we go.
Yeah.